a great pleasure to be here with you today at the, and have been here for a couple of days at the Canada-Africa Business Summit, and to have the opportunity to introduce an esteemed colleague, Jamal Sagar, who's going to be joining us in a moment. He's a fellow Canadian, and he's the keynote speaker for this luncheon address. In my role as Executive Director for Canada, Ireland, and the Caribbean at the World Bank Group, I can attest to Jamal's deep understanding of the Africa region and his extensive experience managing country engagement and some of the most critical investments the World Bank makes in Africa. There's no person better equipped to share insight on the challenges and significant opportunities that exist in the region, in my estimation. As the Senior Regional Advisor in the Office of the Vice President of the Africa Region of the World Bank, Jamal maintains significant responsibilities to ensure the World Bank Group is able to deliver on commitments to the region, especially now as the World Bank Group plays an increasing role in the energy sector and other priority areas. In his position, Jamal plays a key role in fostering work as well across the global practices within the World Bank, across countries and institutions at the regional level, and focusing on a diverse range of industries, including energy, mining, extractives industries, infrastructure, agriculture, climate change, and natural resource management industries. So he has very, very broad responsibilities within the Africa group at the World Bank. He's also responsible for developing multi-year programs drawn from country-level needs and institutional and corporate priorities, and monitoring the implementation of these programs. Responsible, too, for engaging in regional high-level policy dialogue in these sectors and ensuring that high-level institutional priorities are translated into regional work programs. As you can tell, and as you will see from the presentation, Jamal has helped shape much of what the World Bank Group is currently delivering with partner countries in the region, and he will be continuing to do so. In addition, he has also fulfilled many other prominent roles throughout his distinguished career. For instance, he served as resident advisor to the Prime Minister of Tunisia and was responsible for managing a major USAID-funded program in Tunisia to restructure and privatize state-owned enterprises. He also held the position of economic advisor and chief of staff to the Associate Minister of Finance and Privatization in Quebec. At the World Bank Group, he continues to make direct contributions to the twin goals of the World Bank, which my colleague spoke about this morning. And these twin goals we've adopted as a way to guide our partnerships with countries. And both of these twin goals will, of course, contribute greatly to development in Africa. First goal, as many of you know, is to eradicate extreme poverty, to achieve a level of 3% or less for extreme poverty by the year 2030. Second goal is to boost shared prosperity, that is, increasing the income of the bottom 40% in all countries. And the World Bank Group is now aligning its resources and its country partnership frameworks to meet these goals, and I think the African continent will benefit tremendously from these targeted objectives. You heard yesterday from Jamal about the important role of Canadian expertise, know-how, innovation, and investment to support the rise of Africa. That was in the first plenary session yesterday, and we look forward to hearing more from him now about related opportunities during this luncheon address. With that said, I'd like to also thank the Canadian Council on Africa and all the partners of this event, including African leaders and the Government of Canada, for providing us with the opportunity to come together from both public and private sectors at this landmark event. Thank you.
Thank you, Alistair. Excellencies, honorable ministers, member of the Canadian Council on Africa, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a pleasure for me to join this distinguished luncheon in day two of this important summit. Let me first note what I indicated yesterday in the plenary, that Africa has come a long way in the last 15 years, and the outlook is much more positive. Sub-Saharan Africa growth, success is now well accepted. Africa now has two decades of sustained economic growth. The strength and frequency of growth spurt has increased, and Africa is expected to remain one of the fastest growing regions in the world. So yes, the assessment that was done yesterday by all the speakers, and in particular by Ned, on the assessment of the continent that is a good destination for investment is the right one. Growth was supported differently by a robust domestic demand, particularly higher household consumption and public and private investment. But improved macroeconomic management resulted in lower inflation, better fiscal outcome, and lower growth volatility, as captured by less frequent growth collapse and more frequent spurt. So the external factor contributed to this increasingly robust performing. Rising commodity prices, the emergence of China as an important trade and investment partner, and the surge of foreign capital into developing countries due to accommodative monetary policy in the developed world. So capital flow to sub-Saharan Africa reached an estimated 5.3% of the regional GDP last year. That's significantly above the developing country average of 3.9%. So foreign investment is coming in the continent. When we look at the net foreign direct investment inflow to the region, it grew to 16% to a near record of $40 billion in 2013. This is boosted by the new oil, gas, and discovery in many countries, including Angola, Mozambique, and Tanzania. But as I mentioned yesterday, the news is not always all good. The ongoing Ebola virus outbreak in Guinea, Sierra Leone, Liberia, and most tragic example of how unexpected shocks can have devastating consequences. We have just issued this morning at the World Bank at headquarters some data. 2 to 3% of the GDP of this country is gone because of the Ebola, and that's in the short term. This will cost a huge on the economy, this will have huge on the social fabric and then the human aspect. So the continent remains vulnerable to external and unpredictable shocks. Declining commodity prices, economic rebalancing in China, spike in food prices, and growing fiscal deficit are all risks that could negatively impact Africa's economic performance and the progress made thus far in the fight against poverty. A corporate priority for the World Bank is supporting Africa to eliminate extreme poverty by 2030 and boost the prosperity of the bottom 40%. However, our global simulation suggests that between now and 2030, extreme poverty will be increasingly concentrated in Africa, and the region will account for about 77 to 89% of the world extreme poor. This if we continue business as usual. So we have to change the model, we have to change the way we look at it in the fight against poverty. Let me address specifically key areas that are particular importance to Africa. Though growth has not been rising in Africa, it's not reducing poverty as much as though growth has been rising, it has not been have an impact directly on poverty. One reason, as I said yesterday, is that growth has been lagging labor-intensive sectors, such as agriculture and manufacturing, which typically is more poverty-reducing than growth in capital-intensive sectors, such as mineral exploration. And as I said yesterday, except in fast-growing resource-rich countries, Africa growth appeared to be driven by factor accumulation rather than improvement in productivity and in competitiveness. Africa is also being held back by a critical shortage of infrastructure, and we talked about it yesterday. Just to repeat, we talk about the need of around 8 gigawatts per year. What is being put is 1 gigawatt right now. We talk about $40 to $50 billion investment per year to reach universal access by 2030. What being put in investment is around actually $9 to $10 billion. The private sector share of total infrastructure spending is also lower in Africa than in other regions in the world. We looked recently at private sector perception of risk of investing in sub-Saharan Africa, and the broad consensus was that while risk exists, perception is often out of sync with reality. So we must identify real and perceived risk, disaggregate them, political, implementation, financial, demand and supply type risk, and tackle them through appropriate means, including policy transparency and predictability, risk management instrument, and better communication of real success. So boosting access to finance and private investment is crucial to accelerating and sustaining development on the continent. We're also stepping up our support at the World Bank in preparation of high projects. Yesterday, you discussed a lot about what is bankable, what's not bankable. Do we have financing or not financing? The major problem that we at the World Bank see is that projects are not well prepared. When you come to the country, you say, I would like to invest in a hydropower project. Rarely, you see the government or anybody giving you the feasibility study. And you have to spend a lot of money to prepare for this project, and you cannot afford it. That's one of the major impediments to developing these sectors. That's why we believe, like in projects like DRC Inga 3, where we talk about 4 gigawatts, the cost of preparation of this project is around $150 million. The World Bank has provided a concessional loan to the government of DRC to help prepare this project. A project like the Nam Thun project in Laos costed $150 million to prepare for 1 gigawatt project. And what costed also for EDF is another $100 million. So we talk about 10 to 15% of project cost preparation for any of these large projects. And we need to find a mechanism to help you get those projects ready. I remember when I used to work on China. I used to go to China, I sit in the ministry, and I have 5 feasibility studies in front of me and say, pick up which one you want to finance. And they are good feasibility studies. When I travel across the continent, we spend our time financing projects to be prepared. In this context, the World Bank is working on a global infrastructure facility as a platform to help prepare and structure large complex projects. And during the forthcoming annual meeting, this global facility will be launched. And I'm pretty sure will help you also look at some priority of this project. It's clear for us that things are changing in the continent. Let me give you the example of the power sector again, where we have witnessed in the last 3 years a serious startup of energy transformation. We're talking about harnessing a potential of 45 gigawatts of economically feasible hydropower potential. We talk about 15 gigawatts of geothermal, and we talk about 1,000 gigawatts of solar and wind and major new gas discovery. That's what the potential we have here. These are the figures that we have recently that give you to what extent what could be harnessed in this context. The World Bank Group is providing around $1 billion to over 60 countries in the energy sector per year. Our financial instrument risk associated with energy projects are to leverage the private sector, and our policy strategic guidance help government create conditions that attract companies who bring new business model, innovative finance, and new technology. We have been supporting private sector investment in the energy sector through a series of pioneering financing and guarantee instruments. What we have learned is that an integrated approach combining policy dialogue, financing, knowledge, and partnership across the energy chain, generation, transmission, distribution, is required. For instance, specialized instruments of the World Bank Group, including IBRD, IDA, IFC, or MICA, are designed to support specific need of transaction in order to enhance sector investment. For example, our partial risk and partial credit guarantee can reduce the risk perception and enhance the credit worthiness of the public institution that enter into commercial contract with private investor, which means underwriting payment obligation of the government under a PPA. Transaction can also benefit from IFC investment as equity or debt, as well as MIGA guarantee instrument to mitigate political risk and termination of the contract. As mentioned this morning, in Nigeria, the government roadmap of power sector reform initiated a comprehensive policy reform which led to mobilize over $5 billion in private capital in support of improvement in supply capacity as well overall efficiency in the sector. We, the World Bank, we use our PRG instrument around $400 million supporting first-of-kind IPP in Nigeria to support around to cover around $1 billion increase in private investment and add over 1 gigawatt of generation capacity. This is the kind of instrument that I would like to see more of it used for the Canadian companies. We have a lot of them. Sometimes they are not easy to use, but they are really good because we, from our side, we will help you. We provide you the guarantee. We take a counter guarantee from the government. And at the same time, we use the sovereign guarantee. And we link it to our macro dialogue and our other dialogue. And this is the kind of instrument that, in my opinion, the Canadian company should be more and more using them. We're also partnering with government, donors partner agency, as well as the private sector and other stakeholders in order to coordinate and align effort and resources. For instance, the World Bank is working with the Power Africa initiative launched by President Obama last summer. This initiative will support deployment of around 2,500 megawatts of new generation in Africa. We talk about 1,000 megawatts of gas to power in Nigeria, 1,000 megawatts of geothermal in Ethiopia, 100 megawatts of wind in Kenya, and 200 to 300 megawatts in gas to power in Tanzania. These are specific transactions on which we can talk if you want. I can give you more detail. But this is where we see coming, and that's why the Power Africa initiative that the U.S. is launching is an interesting one, because it balances other initiatives that we have seen and also other investment coming from China, India, Brazil, and other places. Going forward, ladies and gentlemen, we believe that Africa cannot take it for granted that sufficient volume of capital will automatically rush in the infrastructure investment from foreign sources. Global activity has broadly strengthened and expected to improve further in 2014 and 15, but it's uneven and uncertain, including in the BRIC countries. So extra efforts will be needed to address perceived risk and leverage the private capital for infrastructure. Risks do exist, as we discussed yesterday afternoon session. For instance, the percentage of PPP projects cancelled or distressed in the period 2006-2012 was higher in sub-Saharan Africa than in other regions, whether measured by term of value, which is 4%, or number of projects, 6%. So this perception is still there. We see a lot of projects being negotiated, a lot of being cancelled, a lot of projects being delayed, and this is much more than other regions. However, when we compare the period 2006-2012 to the period 2000-2006, we have been a major change on the positive side, where Africa is 50% lower in 2006-12 to the period 2000-2006. So differently, the government, the countries, are looking at the risk the way we look at it. But in any event and under any scenario, the private sector will need to play a crucial role in filling the infrastructure deficit. Public financing, whether from Africa government or from international donor agency, will not be sufficient to scale up investment in infrastructure. And we need here, once again, your expertise, your creativity, your financing, your know-how. When I look at certain project finance project, whatever social project or whatever it is, and the creativity that you have put together, that's the kind of things that we need coming from the Canadian companies. We need also your expertise in project finance and structuring the deals. We need a lot of advice on the legal aspect, and here you have among the best lawyers that we have been using. It will be extremely useful if we can use some of this expertise to help us structure those deals. But as you know, when there is severe shortage of bankable project, as I said earlier, and we need to work together to put much more of this project on the market. So, well, as you know, many institutional investors seek stable, long-term income stream from already existing and operational projects. They tend to avoid the level of risks that's really associated with this new project. And we understand that. That's why we from the World Bank Group stand ready to work with you to mitigate this risk, to leverage you, and of course, we put our balance sheet at stake when we work with you. Our assessment analytical work highlighted four critical areas that we see right now require attention. First one, I already talked about it, there is inadequate project preparation. It's not that we don't have project, the project are not well prepared. Second, inadequate project finance. They are not well structured, those projects. Third, policy impediment. And the fourth one that we discussed also yesterday, skill shortage for project management. Most of the time in these countries, we see some good transaction, they go to certain line, then suddenly there is nobody to manage them after you get the deal. You have a PPA, it was signed, it was done, then the problems start. And therefore, 6 months later, we start renegotiating. These four categories are all, of course, linked together. Policy reform, increased funding, better preparation, and improved management and delivery all leverage each other. Policy reform can stretch available investment funding, lower investment risk, and attracts more funds. And that's why we at the World Bank use our policy dialogue, our budgetary support, to help on the policy side. In addition, large multi-country projects will not be realized without strong and informed political leadership and collective action at the highest level and at the working level to align policies, streamline arrangement for structuring, and approving and implementing regional infrastructure projects. And here in this context, our regional infrastructure project is now the largest in sub-Saharan Africa, with total commitment of around $8 billion, mostly concentrated in infrastructure, energy, transport, water, hydropower, irrigation, and ICT. And you will see more and more of those regional projects with national impact. And that's where we believe all the discussion of the power pool, where is the West Africa power pool, the South Africa power pool, the East Africa power pool are important. One of the important projects we financed last year is the highway transmission between Ethiopia and Kenya, which is $1 billion, 1,000 kilometers of transmission. That definitely will help a country like Ethiopia, which has a huge potential of exporting energy, to float it in the market up to Kenya. The next step will be to link it to Tanzania so that we can use also the wind potential that Kenya is doing to take it to Tanzania. And from there, we'd like to go to the landlocked country like Burundi, where the access for electricity is less than 2%, or to go to Rwanda, where it's 6%. With the same question will go in West Africa, where we'll be using the potential of Guinea in terms of hydropower, link it to Senegal, link it to Cote d'Ivoire, link it to Mali, and you will see more of this. The other one will be the Central African one, where definitely with the huge potential of Cameroon, which is another water fountain, I call them, where it is very important to use this potential and see Cameroon as a net exporter of power, thanks to the huge development of hydropower and other resources they are doing. So if we from the World Bank, we believe that it's very important to push this innovation. We'd like to push also a lot on the gas to power, because we believe the gas exploration is now moving very well. It could reduce the cost of energy. This morning we talked about the 15 cent per kilowatt could be solar. However, what we see right now is in many countries, as I said yesterday, people are paying up to 25 to 29 cents per kilowatt. So we are forging a new partnership with international donors and to leverage our finance. For example, we signed an MOU with the China Exim Bank and the China Development Bank on May 2014, and we obtained a board approval for our first parallel financing in the World Bank with China Exim Bank for the Kenya South Sudan project. So we'll be working with China, we'll be working with Kenya, we'll be working with Canada. We had a discussion yesterday, how can we leverage each other? How can we do parallel financing if we cannot do co-financing? We have the same discussion with US, we have the same discussion with the other G8 member. We believe that the G8 have a lot to offer in terms of knowledge, in terms of financing, especially in terms of leverage. And finally, we are not shying away from regional program that involve fragile and post-conflict situation. We're involved in many poor countries. We have a lot of initiative, the Great Lake Initiative, the Sahel Initiative, where we're focusing at the same time on the nexus between peace, security, border discussion, and development, including the need of regional infrastructure. And you will see the development agenda moving a lot toward this idea, where security, peace, development, and infrastructure development, as well as agriculture finance, will be all linked together. In conclusion, the World Bank will work more on regional and national infrastructure projects. In many of the countries, we have a lot of projects in the pipeline. These are projects that will help Africa grow, create jobs, and become truly globally competitive. These are also good opportunity for Canadian companies to be even more involved. We would appreciate Canada know-how, expertise, financing. Canada is a very important partner for the World Bank Group. Thank you.
Mesdames, Messieurs, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank our speaker today at lunch. And you know this on a personal basis, you always need your banker with you at all time. You know, if you don't have a banker, you know you're in trouble. The World Bank has always been there for Africa. It's always been there for corporations. I can tell you on the mining sector, without IFC, many projects would have never developed. Mali would not have, you know, seen its mining sector develop, and many other countries are in a similar position. Today, on the energy front and the infrastructure front, the World Bank will play an extremely vital role for projects to get developed. So I'd like to, you know, give a hand of applause to our banker. We need to make sure he feels warm and fuzzy because we need him to develop our projects. Thank you very much.